It's basketball time.
You know, don't think too much into it. Have fun, play basketball. But at the end of the day, it is a basketball game. And guys play the best basketball when they're having fun. But every possession matters. And, you know, everybody's going to continue to say it over and over. You'll see that, you know, any play can determine or change a series or change a game. And every game, every possession matters. So you can't go in lackadaisical, can't go in missing assignments. You got to be locked in, know your matchups, know your personnel, know who you're guarding, know how we want to execute our principles, and go out there and play and have fun. You know, be scared of the moment.
Wake up, praying that a game's on. Maybe it's the running reps, maybe it's the Knicks, maybe it's a rerun of an old TV show like Hawaii 5-0 or Karate Flicks. Maybe if the phone rings, butterfly will take wings, speaking on some cool things, fronting like I cope. Born under flat ground, now I'm chilling shaky ground, reaching for Pacific Heights, Sunday is my rope. Dig it. Sundays to relax, Sundays to relax. Some Sunday morning drama is calling up my mama. The hotline is in, I guess the Silvers knew the deal. Bobbing off the jams of the cruise on Sugar Hill. Lay around and think, ain't nothing to do. Checking out some From, some Sartre, Camus. Mingus is our damn Roach can drum. The DPs are light, there they go, here they come. It's time to grab some loot, put on the timber boots. Checking out some dollies, like Tasha and Kamali. New York is a museum with its posters and graffiti. If you're in the city on Sunday, come check me, get with me. Get with me.
Rubber Rim Job, Season 2, Episode 10. Jig, I did that in one take. I've been really struggling the last few episodes to get that down.
To get the intro in.
Yeah, just, yeah. I've been like, season, episode, just all over the place.
Oh, yeah, you know what? Yeah.
I've been fucking up.
Old, like, season 2, yada, yada thing.
Struggling. Here it is, the end of Season 2, getting ready for the playoffs, and I finally got it right.
You nailed it.
That's a precursor for the Cavs. Can you hear this?
Congratulations.
Can you hear this?
Transition City.
Yeah?
Transition.
Yeah, I heard that.
Transition City.
So finally, the Rodecaster.
When did I say that?
Oh, that was like season 1, episode 3 or 4. I got a whole...
Was it?
I've got like 4 different sound banks that I think... Listen. Can you hear that?
No.
It's basketball
time. Yeah, I can hear that.
Wait, so how come you didn't hear the laugh one more time?
Out to Booby, three ball, got it!
I can hear your Booby, yeah.
Man.
Get that big stuff out of here!
I can hear that.
Ooh, yeah!
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so I got like 20 sound banks, and I'm like, we went through season 1, we couldn't get them to work. At the end of season 2, I'm finally getting my seasons and episodes right, and I finally got sounds hooked up. So this shit is about to take off.
Well, hopefully this season won't end too quickly.
Right? Ain't that a precursor for this all coming together?
Yeah.
And so our Wine and Gold good guys are preparing for a knockout, drag-out series with the Knickerbockers of New York in a 4-5 matchup. And we're gonna break down the whole playoffs in this episode, Jig. You down with that?
Right. I'm absolutely down with that.
But before we do that, because I think, was it Deezus? Somebody on the board was like, if y'all dudes don't hurry up, hop on and break down these playoffs, I'm going to fuck some shit up.
We've gotten a few of those.
Okay. But what was I getting ready to say? Oh, so have you watched any of these play-in games so far?
I have.
The story seems to be, if you thought you were just going to cruise through the regular season and just flip a switch, that nope. Shit ain't happening, right?
Ain't happening.
In both days now, we had the Miami Heat get upset by the Hawks in that first day. Mm-hmm. The Lakers, who kind of flipped the switch, but they were playing the ultimate, we still haven't flipped the switch yet team in Minnesota. Mm-hmm. That was the battle of teams who didn't want to win that game, and the Lakers mm-hmm. persevered. Mm-hmm. And then in yesterday's games... The Raptors were the ultimate team that was like, oh, we're just fucking around. We're going to flip the switch at some point in time. No.
Yep.
They totally got upset yesterday by the Chicago Bulls. It was, if that game was not, we don't want to win as much as you don't want to win, that game was terrible. And all I'm hearing about today is his daughter screaming at the top of her lungs. And I wish I could just like, that never happened. And then the second game, the ultimate, we just gonna flip the switch, New Orleans Pelicans, with Zion right before the game dunking and doing all this kind of stuff, but then choosing not to play. It was like, what the hell is going on?
Yep.
And they got upset by the Oklahoma City Thunder, who've been missing like half their team all season, but somehow they just keep surprising people, right?
Yep.
So they punched their playoff ticket. This whole season is all about that. So
yep.
I don't know what's going to happen in these games tomorrow where Miami and Chicago determine who gets the 8th seed and Oklahoma and Minnesota on the West determines that. Mm-hmm. You call those for us, and then we'll use that to segue into the regular season. I mean, into the playoff matchups and stuff.
I think I've got the Heat winning that one. So first of all, I want to say that I was watching the Raptors Bulls game last night.
Jesus.
With my brothers-in-law, and I before the game said that the Raptors were going to win because of my experience having watched them during the regular season, but particularly against the Cavs. And I said, you know, these guys are super scrappy,
right?
And you know, they have a bunch of those guys that are not, you know, superstars, but they're just those, you know, quality players, right?
Pull it together.
And then they started beating that ass. And then I said, told you. And then he goes, nah, man, they're going to come back. And I said, you're right. They're going to come back. They're going to get it close. And then, you know, we're sitting there watching. I'm like, you know, damn it. Of course. I shouldn't have opened my mouth.
It was weird, man. Like, I was. They
choke it away. That's how it is when you don't have a star. When you don't have a star player.
Because all of a sudden, Zach LaVine decided to play basketball, and they didn't have an answer for that on the other side. But
that's right.
It was weird watching that game because you've seen teams that are like 1-2-3 Cancun. I've never seen the Raptors do 1-2-3 Cancun. I saw the Bulls do it multiple times.
They play super physically. They're well, you know, they're well coached, and usually teams that are like that don't just give up.
Right.
Because that's
right.
They play in a way that usually gets in the other team's head. It's usually the other team.
Right.
If the other team is of similar quality, that's going to do that. Yeah, that's exactly right.
Man, it was crazy to see that. Like, yeah. I genuinely believe, because there was already whispers and stuff before the season, maybe like 20 games ago, that Nick Nurse was like going to be out.
Right.
And I believe that at some point in time, the nucleus there, everybody kind of checked out on everybody else. Like, you, right, while you're watching them play. Oh shit. Of course I just hit the mic. While you're watching them play, Fred VanVleet, who got it out the mud, and he's always going to bring it every single day.
Absolutely.
He was the only one that you were like, he's trying really hard, but he couldn't guard anybody. Cause he's like the littlest dude. And people were just going around him. Like,
right,
between LaVine and DeRozan, people, it was treating him like a El Matador.
Right.
But everybody else that was supposed to contribute, they were just doing weird shit.
Yep.
The most dangerous outside shooter for them is Gary Trent. And he played like 10 minutes. And he, like, I was like, what is Nick Nurse doing with him? Like, he's supposed to be out there way more than he's out there.
Yep.
It was just a weird thing.
It was a weird game.
I'll say this last thing. And we're going to move on from that game and go on to the other disappointments. So I was a big, strong proponent of Scottie Barnes, but I never said he was supposed to be considered better in any kind of capacity than Evan Mobley.
You did. You said he was going to be better than Mobley.
I was like, the next guy I'll draft after Mobley is Scottie Barnes. I said that early in the season,
okay,
right?
Okay.
But I also had a man crush on Kuminga. So I will say he's starting to look like pretty solid for Golden State, but never mind that. Mm-hmm. If you are like me.
God, that team never misses.
You say what?
That freaking team never misses. Oh, you know what? No, that's not true, because they did miss with
drafting. League. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you're like me, and also they miss with Precious Achiuwa, like that was weird. They gave away Kyle Lowry, and I know Kyle Lowry took off the entire season, but when it was time to play, like, he had like 40 the other day, and I, like, he was vintage Kyle Lowry. Just throwing his fat ass all around the court and stuff. And Precious Achiuwa is like
doing that in the offseason. Guy loves getting chubby.
He loves getting chubby, and then just like Khalid El-Amin. Name some chubby guards that you like. Man, that dude. I'll tell you one. I'm not proud of this as a Tar Heel. Raymond Felton has blown up like a blimp.
He used to get chubby. Yeah.
No. So go look at him right now. He looks like Rick Ross. I don't know what happened to him.
Did he get super, super chubby?
As soon as he stepped off the court, Raymond Felton and Eric Snow are having a contest to see who can get the fattest. Like, I'm like, what happened?
He does look, he looks like, he kind of looks like Kendrick Perkins.
Right? Yeah, he looks like Kendrick Perkins. He looks like Raymond Felton ate Raymond Felton.
I like Raymond Felton too.
But Eric Snow did the same thing. He's got an excuse. He's been out of the league.
Eric Snow was always kind of chunky.
Yeah, he always had like a football build. Like he was a...
he know, did. Oh my God, look at that belly.
Yeah, he was always a Canton McKinley Bulldog. You know, is Eric Snow actually a football player or a point guard who can't shoot?
Right.
You know, but you didn't expect so
here's,
him.
Here's Eric Snow with his like football dad body. You know what I mean? Like, he definitely looks like the football dad on the sideline that you just walk up to him and be like, hey, what's going on, man? Yeah. And he's cool for 30 minutes every weekend.
Then he's, like, drinking a beer in the truck as he drives off.
Exactly. That's exactly right. That's who Eric Snow is.
Yeah, and then Raymond Felton is, he's that guy that probably retired sooner than he wanted to, and he just started eating when he retired instead of doing anything else.
Yeah, it's not, that doesn't look like a beer body. That does just kind of look like the dude.
Food. Yeah, it's just a food body. Eric Snow looks like beer belly, but
definitely Raymond, that's yeah. going that's going straight forward on you.
So which one is Kyle Lowry going to be when he retires? Which blow up?
Definitely going to get chubby.
Yep. I think the dude just likes to eat.
I think he's going to go Felton.
I think he's going to go Felton too. I think
he's going to puff up.
Yeah, I think dude just likes eating, man. Like
I'm thinking he just likes to eat, and I'm thinking that he stays in shape only because he's playing basketball.
Yep. So I somehow got into
what a little discussion we had there.
Yeah, I like good. A little side like that. As you drink your like healthy LaCroix with no sugar and all that kind of stuff in it.
Yeah, but you know what? The thing about LaCroix is that it'll kind of bloat you up a little bit.
Okay. To this day, we had a discussion last season about these drinks, and I haven't ventured there since whatever my daughters say to get, that's what I'm still getting. So
that's how you do it.
I learned absolutely nothing from our discussion.
Water.
Yep. That's right. So we ventured into that discussion off of Precious Achiuwa, who the Raptors went and traded for, being a disappointment. Mm-hmm. He can't, like, he's even backing up Jakob Poeltl. And then Gary Trent, who they traded Norman Powell for. Norman Powell's literally like the third best player on the Clippers. Gary Trent can't even get in the rotation. So they, like, Si Ujiri has been dropping the ball a little bit here.
Yeah. There had been a time where he was the best.
He was beyond reproach.
Yeah, he was. He was for quite a while there.
He's not so untouchable anymore.
Let's talk. You had asked who I thought would win some of these games here. So right. Heat are one of the best coach teams in the league. So you got to think Heat are going to take out the Bulls here.
You got to think that, man. But and then Jimmy Butler has that revenge narrative too. Spent all that time in Chicago. They gave him away. At some point in time, they prioritize other people over him. So he usually shows up against Chicago. So you expect that.
You don't think?
I'm not.
Hawks win bother you?
I've always been some teams with the right vets can just flip the switch. Miami didn't have something. Like, they were missing something. Nope. I get frustrated watching Bam Adebayo play because he's supposed to be better than he actually is, like 90% of the time. Mm-hmm. Like he's right there on the cusp, but he just refuses to be better guy. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like he's getting all these accolades. He's been on dream teams.
Tier guy that should be a tier one guy.
Yeah. Like, and it's frustrating. Like, I feel like we're getting a lot out of Jared Allen, probably more than he should, you know, like he's raising his own bar.
I feel like what you're saying. Yeah. So you feel like Jared Allen, you feel like they should be flip-flopped.
Yes. I feel like Bam Adebayo continues lowering his own bar. Mm-hmm. And he is supposed to be the second best player on that team. Instead, okay. He's like the fourth or fifth behind like Butler, Hero, Lowry, and like one of the twins, like whatever his name is, Cody Martin or something like that. Like, it's like, what are you doing, Bam? Like, why? Okay.
I can dig that.
Why can't we count on you to go get buckets against Clint Capella? Like, what's going on here? So I'm not sure. Vooch might eat his lunch. I'm not sure, Jig. I'm really
talk about an underrated player because he's just there's just too much. He can't get like he's behind when you talk about like all-star votes. He's behind one of the best players of all time out there. You know what I'm saying?
Are we talking about Vooch right now?
Yeah.
He's modern day Z, right? Like,
yeah, he's a good player.
Good player, but it's there. He doesn't try on D, and yeah. Billy Donovan's got to scheme him to be effective on defense. Mm-hmm. But on offense, man, he's got the whole repertoire. You just got to, like Z, we used to feed him the ball on those first possessions and be like, all right, we're going to wait 15 seconds for Z to get a shot. It's kind of like that with Vooch. Like, yeah. he gets like 3-4 assists a game. They run some offense.
Easy, yeah. He's a good shooter. Yeah. Board. Yeah, he's got his limitations, but he's a good player.
So you're sure Miami's going to beat Chicago, even if...
I'm not sure. I mean, look, I mean, the reality is they've had a disappointing season.
They haven't flipped the switch like they were supposed to.
No, they have not. But I don't know. I mean, I think they will. But, I mean, look, I mean, once you get into these, like, 7-10 seed guys,
yeah,
it's hard to guarantee anything. You want to talk, let's talk Lakers-Timberwolves.
Okay.
When you get LeBron into – LeBron is so good. he's so good, man. People counting him out. I don't care. Dude, he's so good. He's so, so good, man. Like, you can't count the dude out.
Yeah. He definitely has transitioned to where he's really playing the game with his brain.
Yeah.
It's funny. Now that he's not for the Cavs, I can watch him, like, bully and pick on his younger teammates, and I can appreciate it because he's like, he's demanding in a different way. Like, he'll totally embarrass his teammates, but it's the, like, he's usually doing it for the right reason. It just used to be frustrating whenever we used to watch him, you know, like, take certain guys out of their comfort, out of their confidence and stuff. Mm-hmm. Like that J.R. Smith play at the end of that game and stuff, and the way Bron showed him up, like, he shouldn't have did that, but that game the other night where they got a steal, Bron made the steal happen, Troy Brown recovered it, and then Troy Brown passed it ahead of Bron. And if Bron wasn't like 50, he would have went and got that ball. He didn't even try, and instead he just shot Troy Brown a look that was like, don't do that shit again. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And I was like, I bet you he don't do that again. And
you ain't going to do it again.
There's always that one guy on the team who doesn't give a shit about whether or not LeBron likes him, and he shows up no matter what. And that's Schroeder now. Like, you knew he was going to make that shot when Brown found him in the corner before he even shot it. Because he has this, I don't care what LeBron thinks about me kind of thing going on. Mm-hmm. But you're right. He's still dominant at 40 years old, and he's dominating with his brain.
People like to give him shit, but the guy's a hell of a player. I'll tell you who else is a good player. Austin Reeves, man. Dude came out of nowhere.
Wait, what were they called? What was his nickname? Hillbilly Kobe or something like that?
What? I don't know is that the nickname they gave him?
I think so. Like, when he first popped, it's Hillbilly something. I think it might be
Hillbilly Kobe. You're right. AR-15 and Hillbilly Kobe. That's funny.
Hillbilly Kobe
look like he should be doing what he's doing out there. Like, he doesn't look like the moves that he's making should be beating people.
Right.
So he must just be really elusive out there. You know what I mean?
The Lakers have a history and their storied purple and gold legacy of finding the most non-basketball looking white dudes and them playing a very critical role. Like,
yeah,
every single team that they've had that shows improves. You can point out that white guy, like Mark Madsen and his dance moves.
Yeah, Mad Dog.
Kurt Rambis and his.
I was going to go back a couple of generations and go with Rambis. Yeah,
Kurt Rambis and everything that he was at some point in time. Even as recent as like Alex Caruso and Hillbilly Kobe, mm-hmm. that bubble team, they had some big white dude that was hitting shots. I can't. I feel like it was a dude from Duke, but. In any case, you catch my drift. Like,
I get your drift.
They've always
guy is probably the best out of all of them if he sustains it.
Yeah, this is totally. And then he's going to get a crazy contract and he's going to be like Jeremy Lin. You're never going to hear from him again when he goes to like.
Possible. It's possible.
Utah.
He's got a pretty good all around game. And I mean, he is shooting at a level that's.
He's balling.
I mean, obviously his last couple haven't been like to the level he'd been at. And it's certainly not sustainable. But he's got a pretty nice all-around game.
I like Hillbilly Kobe. I actually like during his rookie year, there was like a series of memes of him reacting to LeBron where he's like, I don't know.
Yes, those are funny. Like, what the hell?
I was like, I don't know what you're asking me to do, but okay.
I don't know what you're asking me to do, man.
Brown was like, he came up to him and was doing like some metaphysics on his hand. He was like, you know, when A equals B, X equals Y. And I need
you wonder like what he was saying to him.
Sometimes when I see him like doing that and he like tries to like steal some spotlight from some younger dudes, I'll be like, he's not saying shit. He just wants to be in the shot when the when it goes to commercial and they show.
Possibly true. Yeah. Could possibly true.
Come here, kid. Let me could talk possibly. To you. And the kid is like, this is the first time he said anything to me. And I have no idea possibly. What he's talking about.
He just knows that the camera's on them because they just made a big play. Yeah, it could be.
So
could definitely be the case. LeBron's definitely got a nose for the camera.
I'm getting ready to put Bam Adebayo in the same class as Anthony Davis of the most underachieving, supposed to be dominant with all the skills in the world kind of guy. Like, he frustrates the shit out of me. Like, I can't watch Anthony Davis play anymore without wanting to fight him as much as I want to fight Bam Adebayo.
Disappointing. So, yeah. Definitely disappointing. Yeah, he's had a better career than Adebayo, but even still, he could have been better.
Right. He just chose to join LeBron and the Lakers and became a beta. And it was like, you were an ultimate alpha. Like, why did you just do that? Like,
he was shooting threes too. He'd been developing that outside shot. He had the whole game going. Now I'm with you.
Yep.
I'm with you.
And so what were the other games? So we covered Miami, we covered Chicago.
Well, we had that one. And then now we got to talk OKC. I mean, we got to talk OKC Timberwolves here.
We talked earlier this season, and you were talking about how much you like SGA.
SGA. You don't like him. I know. I get it. I mean, anybody talks shit about the Cavs. I mean, obviously, we don't like that.
Yeah.
But I just like – here's what I like about him. Look, it's the same reason that I like what was happening with the bigs. You could see what was happening with the bigs were coming into the game. And as soon as that happened, initially you had them shooting outside. Then you had guys that were facilitating. Now you got bigs that are – you know, playing down low.
Right.
And then it's like, oh, we got this return of the big, right? Which is awesome. Right. Now you get a guy like SGA into the league and he's taken, you know, mid range, but not like that mellow bullshit mid range. Not like your back foot on the 3-point line into the elbow with these shitty shots. Like, he's taking like pretty sweet mid range shots, right? And then, like, he's not the only guy that's doing it. Like, there's other guys that are doing it now. So it's kind of fun to watch the mid-range return a little bit. Garland's doing it, too. Like, it's a thing. Like, you can see it coming back.
No, I agree.
I like that about him. I like that about him.
The ghost of Rip Hamilton is strong in SGA and some of these guys.
Yeah, except he creates. I mean, you know, you figure Rip was all off ball.
Right, right.
And he could get his own shot. Like, SGA is like, dude, it's fun. If he had never said that, he'd be one of your favorites.
He'd be one of the guys like he's
very old.
I don't like Canadian players. I don't know.
Why? What?
I didn't mean to make you spin up your LaCroix. That's not.
Yeah.
I'm a Canadian player hater. Okay.
Why?
I don't know. Like,
what's that?
It's like that Dave Chappelle skit at the player haters ball. Like, I've long hated Canadian players.
That's such a weird skit.
Buck Nasty. I don't like the way these Canadian players, and it's not even like a race thing. It's a nationality. I don't like Canadian players. I don't want them drafted here.
Okay.
I don't want them.
They're too like nice. They're not assertive enough or like.
There's more Andrew Wiggins than there are. They just end up being corny. Like, even like Dylan Brooks, like, you can go through the whole league. If you show me a Canadian player, like, I'm going to be like, I don't like that guy. You know, like, there's something about him. So
can I tell you something real quick?
Please.
Before you get on to that, I like how black people use the word corny. I think it's really funny.
I don't,
because like corny, like when I was like a kid was like, it was just kind of like when somebody would say something was corny, it was like a corny joke. Like, it was sort of like how, like cheesy.
Cheesy,
black people use, like, it's close, like it's close to cheesy, but it's also sort of like, it's mostly intended, like it's like cringe, like it's mostly like
right.
cringe, like it's mostly like a cringy white guy type of thing,
right?
Like, man, being like, if a black person described me as corny, I'd be like,
God damn, I lost.
Yeah.
What is the white dude equivalent to how we?
Like, that's a bad.
Yeah, that's actually, I lost. I'm gonna just stick to these white dudes. What's the white guy equivalent to black dude corny? What do y'all call somebody?
What would we call a black guy that was?
No, corny? No, no. What's so like? If you just you and Damage or whoever, y'all just like having a conversation about, you know, touching each other's dicks and stuff like I do, and y'all go into calling the equivalent of what. If I'm talking to one of my dudes, I'm like, that's corny. What do y'all say? Like, what's the.
Like, about another white guy?
Yeah. Or whoever.
We call white guys call other guys douchebags.
Okay.
Douchebags. Yeah. D- douchebag. Probably douchebag.
Okay.
He's such a douche. He's such a dick.
Yeah, no, yeah, douche, that's what douche, y'all say. Yeah.
Well, even when you get into your 40s, you're still calling guys douchebags a lot. Douchebags.
Like, what would you call Kanye West right now? Like, you would call Kanye, like, a douchebag?
I wouldn't talk about Kanye West now.
What would you call Kyrie Irving?
That's where I go. See, to answer your question, once people do shit like that, I just don't talk about
them.
They're off my radar.
Okay. Because I'm the same way.
I would actually call Kanye West a douchebag. Yes.
Yeah. I have a block list on my Twitter, and there's, like, Kanye is on there. Candace Owens is on there. People that, like... For me, like tap dance and all that kind of stuff for me, like I'm like, you're doing this for the attention and you have no substance to you anymore. I check out, I block them on Twitter. So I totally get what you're saying.
That's what I got to do. Like, cause I know what you're doing. Like, I know why you're doing this. Okay.
And I don't want to react to it. Yep. Okay.
You don't want to react. Exactly. It's like, you stopped being honest with people about like you're not being real. Like, you're not being real. Like with. Exactly. Like when there was a point where like Kanye was like, just look, we all know Kanye is a brilliant person, puts out great music, can do the production. Like we're all there. We're all there with you, man. But like once it became a thing where it's like, you're just becoming a provocateur,
right?
For the purpose of being a provocateur, and you're in tune with what people like, what's going to make people angry. And you're saying it for those purposes only. I don't like that. That's why exactly he said I go dark on that.
Yeah,
kind of
check
stuff.
Out. It's sad. I would you know unprocessed trauma whenever you see it, and you're like, uh-oh.
For sure.
Like this person is spiraling, and then it gets to a point where they go one of two ways, right? And this ain't about to be like a mental health thing, but it goes one of two ways. Either they have like a come to Jesus moment because they hit bottom,
right?
And they do what Meta Artest / Ron Art, whatever his name, whatever you want to call the guy. They do what he did.
Yeah, meta world peace.
Yeah, like he found salvation through recommitting to basketball.
Helps other people.
Right. And so you like there was a point in time maybe 5 years ago before the Kardashian thing where I was like, come on, Kanye, find it. You know, and that My Beautiful Dark Twisted album, I was like, he found it. He's about to be okay. And then he turned right around and was like eating hair grease. I was like, oh, shit. No, he's gone. You know, like
he's dumping it on everybody else.
Yeah. You watched Marbury do it and you were like, come on, Starberry, find it. You know what I'm saying? Like,
exactly.
And the next thing you knew, he was literally eating Vaseline. He was like, no, we lost him. You know, kind of thing.
So, like, he's gone.
Yeah, he's gone. Just,
yep. But yeah, I'm with this. Okay, yeah, okay. 100%. Yep. My big thing is just somebody's going to like start hurting other people like en masse.
You're not going
to
feed the beast.
I'm out. Like, I don't want this person anymore. I'm not listening to their music.
I'm down with you, Jig. Me too.
I'm not honoring this.
I haven't bought or supported a Kanye album since Yeezus for that reason. So I totally get what you're saying. And I'm the same way. I have them filtered out now. I have, you know, the Kardashians have been filtered out since they've been whatever they are. I'm the same way with Canadian players. So when we drafted Tristan Thompson.
Oh, we're back on it.
Yeah. That's how we got there. When we drafted Tristan Thompson, I knew something was wrong. It was like the way he blinked and stuff. I was just like, man, this something. This dude is
going. He blinked.
And they started interviewing him, and he just liked being interviewed too much. And it's just
a thing. Is it really a thing with?
Yeah.
Who else we got here?
So
we got
Dylan Brooks,
RJ Barrett.
RJ Barrett. Oh my God! Don't trust RJ Barrett. He's going to flame on the Knicks. Like watch
Dylan
him.
Brooks.
Yeah,
sucks.
That's I keep bringing him up. Give me some more. I know you got more Canadian players.
Steve Nash is a good dude, right?
Yeah.
No?
Yeah, no. Yeah. Yeah.
Dude, what are your thoughts on Steve Nash?
No, Steve Nash is awesome. I've watched documentaries with him and stuff.
Seems like a good dude.
He's a soccer dude who was like, fuck it, I'll just play ball then.
Are we saying he's an exception to the rule?
Oh, sorry about that. Yeah, I think so.
Bill Wennington's he was kind of a stiff. Oh, that's a good one for white guy. White guy to white guy, stiff.
Yeah, stiff. There you go. Give me like two more Canadian players. I can say
Jamal Murray. Jamal Murray.
He's a front runner. Like when he was cooking Sexton that one game, I'll never forget it. He dropped like 50 on Sexton. But then if he goes up against somebody that's like real, he like totally shuts down. Even though him and
I got one for you, Kevin Pangos.
It was fighting.
Oh, I got one more.
It was fighting words right there.
Anthony Bennett.
Yeah. See that. So I'm traumatized by Canadian players. Don't bring up any, like you can keep going down the line, but I'm not going. So that's where SGA, That's where me and SGA, before he even said anything about Cleveland, I was like, I don't want you anyway because you're from Canada. So, like, you can just go away now.
Sam D'Alembert was Canadian? I thought he was, like, Haitian.
He was Haitian. There's
Haitian-Canadian. He was Haitian-Canadian. Yeah. He's the only Haitian-Canadian human being on Earth.
He's Haitian. They got stories about him eating, like, turkey necks and stuff on planes.
Was he dipping it in gravy?
I'll tell you where it came from. Andre Iguodala's book. I read his book last year.
Is that right?
And, you know, because he semi-retired, and then he went back to the Warriors. But he, like, exposed a lot of stuff that he wasn't supposed to do. And I didn't think
Andre did?
Yeah, Iguodala in his book. Oh, yeah. He told all kinds of stories. He put, you know, some Draymond stuff out there. He put Bob Myers.
Right. Yes,
yeah. Right. Yes. He told some truths that it was like, holy shit, I can't believe they signed him back. But he talked about his early career part when he was with Philadelphia and Samuel D'Alembert, who's super brilliant. He said he would like, he kept all his game checks just like Manny Ramirez. He never cashed them. He was living like check to check. And he also said that Samuel D'Alembert like had a super high IQ. I think he went to like Villanova or something.
Okay.
But he would like randomly, he would bring electronics on the plane. If they were flying across country, he would disassemble and reassemble DVD players. Guys. Yeah. Like he just like built computers from the ground up with like no,
cool.
No type of manual.
I like that type of dude. It's like little man Tate.
Yeah. What about, what's his name from Pacific, number one pick? Is Michael Olowokandi, is he Canadian? Or is he just...
Oh my God, Olowokandi, the candy man.
Is he just like an islander? I think he's just from the island.
I think he was an islander. He was an island boy.
Those guys don't touch either. You know, Michael Olowokandi, DeAndre Ayton. There's only one guy that was the exception down there, and that's Tim Duncan. Yep. Everybody else don't touch.
He was Nigerian. Olowokandi was Nigerian.
He could care less. He was just there to get them checks from like day one, so... Anyway,
now you can go with African guys, right? Or are there, is Akeem?
I love African
guys. You like African guys?
Like they're literally out there playing for their entire tribe.
That's what I was thinking. I mean, you figure that these dudes, yeah, actually there's a pretty long list here of African guys.
There's
very
long
list.
I just got done reading the Giannis book right before the
long list.
Right before the Iguodala book, I read the Giannis book, and he where is he from? Oh, shit. I was about to say Cameroon, but that's JoJo Embiid and Siakam. Yep. I can't remember where he's from, but he's not Greece. He's not Greek.
You talking about Giannis?
Yes.
He's Greek Nigerian.
Nigerian, okay. And he talked, you know, his whole story, he got it off the mud. So you knew once he got in the league, he was going to do everything he could. JoJo Embiid, Hakeem Olajuwon, like, them dudes are the real deal.
They are the real deal.
The exception is, what's his name? The guard who got drafted by Golden State, Emmanuel Mudiay. What the hell was that? Like, that was terrible. Like, I don't know where. You remember him? He went.
I do remember him.
Okay. He went straight out of high school.
I remember him kind of flaming out, but I don't even remember where he got picked, to be honest with you.
He got drafted by the Nuggets, and I want to say number six or so. Like, he might have got drafted ahead of guys he definitely shouldn't have got drafted ahead of.
Do you remember that picture of Manute Bol in a pool?
I do not.
A picture of him?
A picture of Manute Bol.
It's terrifying.
Every time I think of a person in a pool, I think of Muhammad Ali, that underwater in Miami.
Yeah.
Where he's doing a thing.
Cool one. No, there's a picture of Manute Bol in a pool. And, like, he's so long.
Yeah.
And, like, it looks like it's something about it. It's very disturbing.
It just looks unreal.
It's unreal. Like a human being like that long, like swimming in a pool. It looks, I don't know. It sets off the like shark alarm in my head.
That's what Wembanyama looks like. That's what Chet Holmgren looks like. That's what
Holmgren does it to me as well. He makes me uncomfortable.
He makes me uncomfortable because you know he's going to snap and like in like some limb or something. You just know it's going to happen. Like it doesn't feel right. Bol down in Orlando. He's fun to watch because he
sets off some. Yeah, he really kind of makes you feel like when you're watching him, you're like, man, like what if he could do this 10 times a game?
He's got a weird thing because he's actually got a guard skill set.
Yeah.
But there's still a feeling like something's going to fall apart if he actually.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
He's one of those players that, I don't know, I feel like he's going to trick teams a few times in his career.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I feel like he's probably a hard worker. I mean, his dad was for a long time, but I can't speak that much to Bull Bull.
Okay.
Or why his name is Double Bull like that. But I will say that whenever I've seen him, I've enjoyed him. Do we want to talk Cavs?
Last thing was where's Taco Fall from exactly? Taco
Fall.
Yeah.
I feel like he was from somewhere weird, like Senegal.
I think so. He looks Senegalese.
He was Senegalese.
Good call, man. Jiggy be killing it, man, when it comes to this.
Right?
Like, can you trace my roots just by looking at me? Like, I feel like you'd be like probably hit it on the head. Don't do that in real time. So back to the Cavs. And we totally got off. What we were talking about was SGA OKC that game. Then we'll go into the Cavs and their series, and then we'll cover the other playoff series. So we'll be a little disciplined on this beautiful Thursday spring day here.
Okay.
How did you feel about the OKC game? Because it was totally unexpected.
I didn't get to watch a game.
Okay.
I'll be honest. I didn't get to watch the OKC game.
It was weird because they had OKC. I'm sorry. New Orleans had like four or five guys they could throw at Giddy and SGA. Mm-hmm. They had Herb Jones, who I love watching him play defense. He reminds me of Bridges back in Phoenix. He plays that role to a T. He was totally getting under his skin in the first half. Herb Jones and Trey Murphy the third, they held Giddy and SGA to like 19 points in the first half combined. They were like 4 for like 20-something. Mm-hmm. They weren't doing anything, but Lou Dort, the Isaac Okoro inspiration, he had like 20 in the first half. Like, he was balling. Like, they totally just ignored him to Wall, SGA, and Giddy. And Lou Dort made him pay in the first half. Then in the second half, they adjusted what they were doing. And OKC just was like, all right, now let's go. And it was like, wait, this team looks legit. Like, they're going to be against the 2 seed, which I don't, who is that in the West? The 2 seed for OKC?
The 2 seed's the Grizz.
They're going against Memphis. I don't think so, but
Thunder are playing the Nuggets.
How's that possible? Oh, so the Thunder have to win the next game they play.
So the Thunder are playing the Timberwolves.
Got it. And then that game determines who's the 8 seed. The okay.
And then the Grizzlies are the 2 playing the Lakers.
The Lakers are locked in against the Grizz. Got it. Okay. Sorry. Right. I'm totally This thing is confusing. I like the way it's set up.
It is confusing. It's hard to keep track of everything.
I like the way it's set up. 7-8, you win one.
I do too. I enjoy the plan.
Yeah. You win one, you go in, you're locked in, and then that 8 seed or whoever that loser that gets another chance.
Lose the 9-10, though, you're out.
Yeah. Yeah. You lose that 9-10, you're done. I like that. So, it's been fun these first couple of days of play-in and everything, but I feel like you got Miami and you've got the other team that's already locked in, Chicago. And in the West, you feel OKC is going to beat Minnesota. And we got the Lakers against the Nuggets. So let's break these series down. Let's start off with our beautiful, always they played this way all throughout the season. And now it's playoff time. They're going to play the same way. The Cleveland Cavaliers against the Knicks. How you see this thing playing out here?
I think it's going to go the whole series.
7-gamer.
I think it's going to go 7. And I do think the Cavs are going to win.
Okay.
But I'm seeing people saying like 6 or the Cavs are going to have an easy timer with them. No way.
I don't think so.
No way.
Yep.
I think it's going to be a knockdown, drag out fight. I think that, I do think that the Knicks would be better off without Julius Randle.
I agree with you 100%.
I think that what we saw of them in that game that we watched when they didn't have Randle was actually the problem with the Cavs that game was that they don't like defending the 3-point line. And that's kind of their game. Their game is that they like defending the paint. They like packing the paint. But the problem is when you're playing a team that likes shooting threes, you're going to have to adjust. So.
They play entirely outside in. Their post presence is Randle, but he never likes posting. So it's like a weird, we'll just play. We'll do the post on like a, garbage committee thing, Mitch Robinson. Mm-hmm. That's where Barrett is getting his buckets now. Mm-hmm. And then they went and got the ultimate trash guy who loves playing that trash position in Josh Hart. That worries me. He worries me.
He's definitely an X factor. And I mean, the reality to me is that the Knicks are going to hit a bunch of threes. They've got a lot of talent on that team. And Hart is going to be a problem. Brunson's going to be a problem, man. I mean, he's going to score a ton of points on them.
Can we admit something? I agree with you 100%. Can we admit something real quick?
Yeah.
If you watch that Atlanta game, of course, Clint Capella had like 50 rebounds. But the real X factor was Sadiq Bey coming off the bench and scoring like 20. It was like, man, at the trade deadline, we were like, man, fuck. Like, why did they just give him away and why did they give him to Atlanta? But we didn't know it was going to play a part in something like that.
Sure.
But then you go down the line, these Villanova dudes everywhere, Miles Bridges in Brooklyn, Brunson and Hart in New York. Like, they just know how to play the game. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And when it comes down to it, they're made for playoff basketball.
Right.
That worries me because they've got a couple of them. They got a couple of them in New York.
Well, what the Cavs are going to need. I mean, we know that the Cavs have the best player on the floor for sure. And Donovan. Garland is probably. I think he's tied with Brunson, or you think he's better than Brunson?
I feel like he's just behind Brunson. Brunson's done it.
That's fair.
At a playoff level, like where you actually didn't want Luka to even come back during that second round series. And Garland hasn't ascended to that place yet where you're like, no, just give him the ball. He did it once in that 50 burger game that he had.
Right.
I don't know who we were playing, but he did it once. But that wasn't like what Brunson's done playoff wise. So,
So there's that. And then Mobley is obviously one of the better all-around players in this series. I mean, and you figure he's going to cause the Knicks problems. But again, the Knicks, they're not going to mess around with him too much because they're going to be hanging out on the perimeter. So you figure what impact Mobley's going to have is going to be when Hart's trying to get to the basket. If Randall's trying to mess around down low, that's when you're going to see Mobley having a big impact on him. I mean, the good thing is Mobley can defend all the way out to the 3-point line.
Right.
But the reality is these guys they're going to have to defend and rotate at the 3-point line. And if they think they're going to pack the paint, then they're going to watch these 15 point runs like they had when they had trouble with the Knicks during the regular season. And I have to anticipate that whenever JBB got on the phone with Tito Francona, that Tito like told that. Him that if you're gonna he if said you're he, gonna play defense against a team, you can't be giving up 15-point bursts.
Tito, so I haven't missed a single Guardians game, and before the game yesterday, which was really weird, they did some Aaron Boone got tossed at the beginning of the game because of a weird they had a pop fly. And dude obviously dropped it, and that was all kinds of stuff. But before the game, Tito was talking about his time with JB, where he was like, "We're not gonna do this over the phone. Come on down to the Prague, I guess. I don't know what the nickname is for it.
It's the Prague Rush. Stupid.
Come on down to the Jake, and let's have a conversation.
It's always
gonna be the Jake, just like the Rock is actually the Q still.
The queue.
And he said, he came down and I was talking to him about pick and roll. And then, he got a laugh out of everybody. But then he was like, no, it's the same. When you're talking about young guys trying to break through, you got to talk about that want to when it comes down to the game and stuff. And I was like, man, I love Tito.
I did too.
You got to love Tito. And if Tito is, sharing some of that wisdom with a JBB, that's a good look.
It's good that he's going outside of himself, man. I mean, you don't want, I know some guys talk about a bunker mentality and keeping it internal. And I mean, sure, that's one approach. But I mean, the fact that he was going outside of himself and asking for input from one of the best baseball managers of all time, I mean, that's pretty cool. I mean, it's your players here that you're doing that. I'm sure they respect that. But I mean, look, obviously, Tito's not going to be telling him to have his guys guarding out to the 3-point line. That's the single, to me, that is the single biggest thing to me. That he's not just sitting and thinking he's going to pack the paint all series. The after timeout stuff is a big deal too. But look, again, we have Donovan Mitchell. So are they going to lose, you know, four games off of after timeout issues? Probably not.
Right.
But is that going to be an issue a couple times? I don't know. I mean, I hope not, but we do happen to have a guy that can carry them. I mean, in seven games, if they need to at the end. I hope that's not the way that these games go. I hope that we can watch some games where Mobley's scoring, getting the ball a little bit in the fourth quarter. I really want to see that.
Right.
He's proven effective when he gets the ball in the fourth quarter.
All right. So we, our call here, the official RRJ call, of course, is Cavs in seven.
I think Cavs are going to win in seven. Okay. I don't think they're going to win in six, though.
For some, I can't help it. I got the Cavs in six, but it's not some like uber confident kind of thing. It is, I'm counting on Julius Randle demanding to be a part of what the Knicks are trying to do.
Yeah.
They got the money tied up in him. Even though they look better without him, he's going to play out of control. And he's going to try to force himself in ways that make the Cavs easier to guard. One of the X factors for us is Okoro's health, of course. There's a couple of X factors for us. Okoro's health, Rubio's health. You know, like he's started the last couple games and you're just kind of like, I think he's back. I think he's back in shape and stuff. And then, you know, LeVert's involvement as an X factor off the bench. And we got three of those guys. They got one. They got just Josh Hart that you're like, he can swing the game depending on his impact and stuff. So
I'm very excited about LeVert in this series.
Okay. I'm down with that.
Very excited about LeVert. So, I'm very nervous about literally the entire rest of the bench.
I've got Cavs in six. You've got Cavs in seven, but we got the Cavs no matter what.
I do believe in the Cavs. I'm sure if I was a Knicks fan, I would be believing in the Knicks. It seems to be across the media to be, you know, kind of one of those could go either way, which I think is reasonable.
Right.
But I do think if I could see this thing going either way. But I think if Randle's out there, I think the Knicks are going to be worse off.
I agree. We don't really have an official update on that for him. It's just, we're all just kind of playing it by ear.
Just that he was quote unquote doing better at least a day ago. Let's take a look. Let's see where he's at. Participated in limited practice Tuesday. That was it. Limited practice Tuesday.
All right.
I hope he plays. I hope he plays because the offense won't be as free flowing. That means that that's the last time for Brunson to have the ball in his hands.
Right. So then after that, we've got, what is 1-8 in the East? We've got the Milwaukee Bucks and your Miami Heat that you just called.
Assuming the Heat playing, yeah.
Sure.
Bucks versus somebody.
And what do you have the Bucks winning in? Like how many games do you think?
I think it'll be a 4-1.
I was just about to say, Jig, what's going on, man? I think we're connected. Because I was about to say a 5-game series because I am not sure. And the only game Miami's going to win is that first home game. So it'll be two games, Milwaukee easy. Miami's going to steal one, and then Milwaukee's going to close them out kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anything in that series that you think – I honestly just think the Heat are too old and they're too small. Like,
yeah, they don't have anybody – I mean, look, Butler's a – he's an awesome player.
Sure.
But he's not going to will them to even two wins, in my opinion.
Like the way Adebayo's playing right now, him and almost like Bobby Portis are like a wash. Like he, right. I don't know how he fares against Giannis, and I would think he'd be the primary defender for him. But then who's guarding Brook Lopez? Because are they going to put Kevin Love? Like what are they, like what is that? You know, kind of thing.
What a wild career Brook Lopez has had.
I agree, because he was while he was in Brooklyn, he was actually the man, but it was like their teams were terrible. Then he went to the Lakers and actually showed something for a second. And then he just like had this weird resurgence where you're like,
it's a total full-on resurgence, man. And he's a defensive player of the year.
Right.
Maybe close.
Like he's one of the best rim protectors in the league.
He was fading for a minute there. Even in Milwaukee, it kind of looked like he might be fading a little bit.
Is he on like a two... is he like on a vet minimum contract? I think like it's kind of weird, like watching him.
I'm not sure. He's playing 30 minutes a season. He's 30 minutes a game here. He played 78 games a season.
They got him for like bargain basement when they got him. It was so crazy.
I bet.
And Bud was literally like, hey, no, I just want you to play like that Horford role and, you know, just man my defense back there behind Giannis. And he's like, that's what he's, I feel like he can do it for like another 3 or 4 years or something like that.
He started shooting threes back in Brooklyn, and he makes a bunch of them too.
You know who did that for him? That was Atkinson right there. Like, he was like, you know what, let's unlock your game. Like, what are we doing here?
Remember Mark Gasol started doing that, and then that kind of opened up his game. And then I think it was around the same time, actually.
I actually really liked when Mark Gasol like transitioned, you know, because him and Z-Bo together, they just went from being this, you know, knock them down, mash them down, grit and grind, to like floor spacing. Like, you want to play in the post? Because I'll come out here. Like, and they were just like, it was like, man, that's pretty awesome. They can do that.
Yeah. No, I mean, I love Brook Lopez. I really loved when Mobley handed his ass to him.
I like that too.
That was an awesome. That was Mobley's coming out game.
And the irony is going to be that if we take care of business, like we say, and the Bucks do what they're supposed to do 4-1, that's going to be our next round. So we won't touch on that this episode. We'll save that for.
We'll save that.
Yeah.
They got to win game one first.
Yep. So 2 and 7 are locked in. That's Atlanta and Boston. Okay.
Atlanta, Boston.
How do you see that playing out? Because
I think Atlanta could take a couple games off of them.
I was getting ready to say the total opposite. I was getting ready to say a sweep.
You think it's gonna be a sweep?
I think that might be where we finally see our first sweep.
You think so?
Yeah, oh yeah. Like that. The fact that Miami rolled over the way they did for Atlanta does not make Atlanta like a better team to me. I know Quinn Snyder, that who the guys are affectionately calling Coach Q, like he's that guy now. Mm-hmm. And I'm hating because he was like on one of my wish lists, but the way fate would have it, we weren't supposed to, you know, transition off to anybody else. So,
right.
Coach Q, as the dudes in Atlanta are calling him now, he's a good game planner. Like he came up with something for the Heat where they kind of blitzkrieged them, and the Heat were never really in that game. Mm-hmm. I don't think you can do that against Boston. That Boston is still Boston. They, mm-hmm. you know, who's going to guard Tatum? There's the whole Tatum. There's
bad
the whole
matchup.
Yeah, that's a bad matchup. Brown is from Atlanta, and he likes to show out. He's doing this whole petition and behind the scenes thing for a new contract from him, but they're not like actually like unsettled. Mm-hmm. And then they've just got like the near perfect lineup, you know, like with a mix of vets and Al Horford keeping the locker room together, Marcus Smart being a DPOY himself. Like, Atlanta can't contend with that. I think it's going to be a sweep, but
we'll sweep them. Okay.
What did you have? Did you say 4-2? You said a couple of games.
I thought they might be able to pull a couple games off them. I thought Trey could go absolutely apeshit on them, and that they could play some good defense at the bucket on them. But
they're the type of defense that would entirely render DeJounte Murray like ineffective. Mm-hmm. Like, and he's going to be a big part of the Atlanta offense. And I feel like he feeds right into what Boston's got going. I don't know what their season series look like. I can check it out real quick, but I truly believe that might be a sweep that we're looking at. Yeah.
Could be a sweep.
So you got 4-2. I got a sweep for that. 3-6 is going to be
Sixers Nets. I felt like that could be a sweep.
I feel like that could be a sweep too. They got Philly is
should be
irritatingly versatile. Like they
are.
Like there were some guys that they went and grabbed and plugged in and stuff. And I was like, wait, how did that happen? Like when did that?
Right.
Like,
right.
They got McDaniels from Charlotte. Like they got players that's like they're 8 through 10 are guys that you're like, what the hell? And then
they could win.
They've got this weird.
They could win this year.
You know, the Sixers, I believe so too. They got the MVP of the league, and there's nobody in Brooklyn that can contend with that. They got that.
This would be a good year for them.
Yeah, they got that weird little skinny. What's his name? The center for Brooklyn, Nick Claxton.
Yeah.
God, please be with him when it comes to him going against Embiid, because this dude is probably going to be on a mission not to get. Can't have MVPs getting upset in the first round anymore.
Right.
And then you got the whole Brooklyn history with James Harden and everything that goes with that. You know, he's going to want to be his best James Harden in that mm-hmm. first round series.
Mm-hmm.
I like a sweep for that series as well as
you. I think we're looking at a sweep there.
Yep. So that covers the East. We got that 1-8 matchup, Milwaukee. I've got, what did I say? Was it 4-1? Milwaukee, Miami. Mm-hmm. And the 2-7 with Boston, I've got a sweep. You've got 4-2. Mm-hmm. In the 3-6, we both got a sweep with Philly. And then the 4-5, you got 7 games. I got 6, both Cleveland. Moving on. Mm-hmm. How about that West Coast? How are we looking with the one seeded?
So we got West Coast. We've got 1-8. We got Denver, Minnesota.
Oh, you got Minnesota going for the 8 seed.
Well, no, hang on a second. What am I looking at? Am I looking at Denver? I don't know. I don't know. I don't know who I got. I guess I'm going to have to – I'm going to say Denver, Minnesota. And then I'm going to say Denver is going to go 4-1.
4-1 over Minnesota? Mm-hmm. Okay. I do like Mike Conley, but I do not believe that they're going to beat OKC. I genuinely believe, because Gobert is going to be back for the game. And I think, you know, OKC has absolutely no center.
He hurts them.
He hurts them. He has nobody to guard because they play this weird floor spacing, equal opportunity, ball moving. Right. One of the top paced offenses. And I know Minnesota wants to run and stuff, mm-hmm. I guess. But they're going to be playing 4-on-5 for every minute that Gobert is out there.
Mm-hmm. You're right.
I like OKC beating them, but whether it's OKC or Minnesota, Denver frustrates me because they're the team I can see underachieving this year. Like, there's something weird about them, Jig. I don't know what it is. Like, Jokic is fun.
I know.
He's fun to watch.
They never seem to quite be able to get over the hurdle.
It's like that Jerry curl that just won't curl. You know what I'm saying? Like this. It's like, man, like, I really like watching Denver at times.
Yeah, me too.
But then they also frustrate the shit out of me at times. It's like,
right.
I could see that being like a 4-2, whether it's Minnesota or OKC. And I'm being sincere. I can literally see OKC taking 2 games from Denver.
I could as well. I agree. Absolutely.
Jokic doesn't play any D, so they count on Aaron Gordon and Thomas Bryant, which Thomas Bryant doesn't play any D either.
Well, you're cutting in a perimeter guy, yeah.
Yeah. Right. So if they end up with Cat, then Cat's going to have a game or two where he wins that. So, yeah, I got it 4-2.
Okay.
What about 2-7, which is our Lakers?
2-7's Grizz Lakers.
Yep.
it's an interesting one, right? You got the Lakers at number 7. Man, LeBron, he could go in there and win, couldn't he?
I don't think so. I'm not even a LeBron hater when I say that. Like, the perfect matchup for Anthony Davis to make sure he's not as impactful is Jaren Jackson Jr.
For sure. Jaren Jackson Jr. is a perfect, well, he's a perfect awful matchup for everybody in the league. I mean, he's an awesome defender. Look, I think you're probably right that the Grizzlies are going to win, but I don't think they're going to sweep them. I don't think they're going to sweep them.
Yeah, I don't think so either. You can't.
That's going 6 or 7.
Oh.
And, oh God, it's so hard to count LeBron. I mean, can you picture games that are going into the fourth quarter close? I mean, do you just picture LeBron, like, wilting?
Honestly, Jig, he has. So we just got done singing his praises at the beginning of the episode. He has lost a step. He is like a tad bit behind now. And the Grizzlies, of all the teams that are up there, I mean, Denver would be the worst matchup for him because they got, you know, Aaron Gordon. They got a bunch of young, capable defenders who can make his life like really hard.
Sure. And he doesn't have as much talent around him.
But yeah. Memphis is right after that. Like, they got a lot of weird switching, interchangeable guys.
Yeah.
They got a dumb guy in Dylan Brooks, which we just talked about. Who wants to make, like, he's right now planning ways to try to get LeBron into LeBron's head right now.
It's Stevenson shit.
Yep. The Deshaun Stevenson slash you know, some of those LeBron nemesis from the past kind of thing.
And you can do that Lance Stevenson, like blowing in his ears.
Right. Like you, like, I think I saw him with like a perm the other day and I was just like, this dude's about to do something stupid in this series. Like
he's a weird guy. Man. He's a weird, weird guy. One of the weirdest guys I can remember in the NBA.
But then after him,
I would not want him to be my teammate.
After him, they've got these young dudes that's like, you know, like these weird dudes that actually like really play a good role, like Aldama and Roddy and these dudes that like LeBron would have trouble keeping up with. Like they like they can make them.
So run. What do you got? You got that. I mean, do you have them? How many games you got that going?
4-2.
You got Memphis, but how many games?
Memphis 4-2. So I got to go in 6.
4-2. I think that sounds about right. Yeah. I'm with you on 4-2.
And I can genuinely see LeBron run out of steam. I don't think they beat them in Memphis one time. Yeah.
He was hurt. I mean, he was hurt recently. Maybe he was just setting up the narrative. Maybe he wasn't even hurt. Maybe it was just the elbow.
Nursing
when he
himself.
Had his elbow.
Yeah. Magic. I went down to Miami for a couple of weeks, got a shot, now I'm back and I'm ready to dominate kind of thing.
Yeah, exactly.
Did you have 4-2 for that series as well? Or do you think the Lakers
I'm with you on 4-2. Okay. I like 4-2.
3-7, 3-6 in the West. We've got
Poor Kings have to do their first year against the Warriors.
And I said this, I was like, everybody's going to be licking their chops. One of these teams is going to be smart enough to make sure that they get the Kings. And that sucks.
Feel bad for Mike Brown.
They don't play a lick of defense at all. The Warriors are, I don't know what just happened, but they actually did flip a switch.
Of course. They would.
Their acquisition of Gary Payton Jr., like he's going to play. He's going to be their Josh Hart X factor. Mm-hmm. I think they're going to win two series, and I think he's going to be the X factor in both because they can literally
just. Warriors won two series?
At the very least.
Yeah, I was going to say, that at the very least.
But starting here with the Kings, I don't think we're going to be able to light the beam at all. I think that there may be a sweep in this 3-6.
I agree.
So
I agree.
I don't want to see
give
it.
I'm going to give the Kings one game in this one. So.
All right.
The Warriors will drop a game sometimes.
Well, here's the scary thing about it.
This isn't Durant Warriors. This isn't like early Steph Warriors. Okay. I think they're going to drop a game because the Kings can score a lot of points.
Here's the scary thing about it. They have their entire team and offense built around Sabonis. He has notoriously been terrible in the playoffs. Like when he was doing it for the Pacers and we faced him, I think he averaged like 9 points a game.
Was he bad against the Cavs?
Yeah.
Yeah, because they were going all with
Oladipo. It was all Oladipo.
Oladipo. Yeah, and he did have some good games. Yeah, you're right. That's right.
Now, don't get me wrong. Sabonis was setting picks and stuff, but with the Warriors. With the Warriors, that's not going to be the difference that they need.
No.
The one benefit that they have is Mike Brown knows that team inside and out. Like he literally knows how to game plan for each of the guys. Oh yeah,
he does. You know, and he's getting better in game too.
So, you think 4-1
game out of there?
Okay, I'm going sweep.
I'm going 4-1.
The 4-5 in the West as we
an
wrap
interesting
up.
One. I like that one.
Who do we got?
Got my eye on that one. You know, I told you I like the Durant career arc.
Ah, Phoenix and Clippers.
I like how Durant went from. The whole, you know, thin-skinned, you know, guy. You know, he destroyed the league. We can all acknowledge that. Sure. But I like how he went from that, like, thin-skinned, like, fighting random dudes on the internet to like,
Hollywood Hogan.
Yeah, exactly. To just total heel. He'll just throw reporters out there and skin them publicly thing. I like what he's doing. I understand that. He's unlikable, quote unquote, but I enjoy the entertainment value.
Right.
I'm not necessarily rooting for him, but I enjoy his whole persona.
Can I surprise you with something here?
Please do.
It's looking more and more likely that the Clippers won't have Paul George at all.
Is that right?
Yeah. So he's
really?
Yeah. So whatever he suffered with that knee.
Didn't know that. Well, then that series is over.
Yeah. So I genuinely think it's going to be a sweep.
Out for start a series.
He's going to miss the entire series. So I thought that if he would have been healthy, we would be talking about a 7-game series, knockout, drag out. and the Clippers are going to pick on DeAndre Ayton and Chris Paul, and you know the history that's there between you know Phoenix and the Clippers in regard to you know Chris Paul and all that kind of stuff. There's none of that now. Like the what the Clippers will need in order to actually pull off things, the Phoenix Suns have in spades. That's like they got your Josh Okogie. They've got these dudes that are like these, you know, that are like Rocco or whatever the Clippers might pull out their ass, Norman Powell kind of thing.
Right.
Those guys are like the 7, 8, 9, 10 guy for Phoenix. They're just too deep. These dudes are too old and hungry. Like I don't like to admit this, but without Paul George, they don't stand a chance, to be honest.
No, they have no chance whatsoever. I didn't realize that.
Yep.
Did not realize that. That's a sweep.
Now, Ty Lue is going to do some crazy stuff because he's a statistician. Is that a
good
word?
Coach. Statistician. Yeah, he's a good coach. But if he doesn't tactician. Have Paul George out there, he doesn't have a chance.
Yeah,
the Suns are too good. If this was some other team,
they're going to do some weird stuff. So, like, they'll take Zubac and Plumlee off the floor, and they'll play like five guards. They'll do Kawhi at center, right, and try to get Phoenix to like play their way. And just throw a whole bunch of defenders at KD and Book, but it won't work in this case.
No, like, I don't see him being able to do anything here. I think
you want to have fun and just say, you know what, let's play four out with like let Russell Westbrook like try to catch lightning in a bottle.
Right.
As much as he could catch lightning in a bottle, he's going to give away a couple games. So
absolutely,
I think it's a sweep. So
I do not like Russ Westbrook as a player.
Yeah. I used to love Russ, but it was more like, it was more like because he just tried hard and just went full. I wouldn't want him on my team. I wouldn't want to watch that because it's bad basketball. No. It's like Colin Sexton on steroids. I do not want to watch that happen.
Oh no, you definitely don't want to play on a team with that guy.
Yep. I did just now say a second ago that the Brooklyn Philadelphia series is going to be a total sweep. And then I remembered they have this new age Colin Sexton and Cam Thomas. The only way that they will actually steal a game is if he goes in fuego, like he has a tendency to do sometimes. In this game, in the LA Clippers and Phoenix, I can't see that. Like, I don't see anybody on the Clippers who has the ability to do
it. I don't see them pulling even a game. You know what, though? It's there's not that many sweeps every year. Usually teams pull out a game.
You know why? Like the refs, like they're like, "Hey, let's make this series a little interesting. Yeah, like so.
Yeah, yeah. That's think, probably true.
And Monty Williams has had a tough year with refs. Like I think he's been fined like more than any other coach.
Has he?
He just keeps finding weird ways to get himself in trouble with the establishment. Yeah,
you don't see that many sweeps.
Yeah,
it's probably more realistic.
Because I'm over here calling for Sweep City in the first round, and you're like, "I don't think so." Like,
probably more realistic to expect 4-1s. Even those old Cavs teams, those solid Cavs teams didn't
steal a game here.
Many sweeps, and neither did the Warriors.
Yeah.
Warriors were really, they were going more 4-1s.
Well, that was more like a LeBron thing though. Like, cause you would be like, no, we can take care of this. Like that series where we went 7 against the Pacers, like we just talked about.
Yep.
That was Bron just chilling where you're like,
can first game they got. Yeah. Well, there was a Celtics series like that too.
Yeah. Are you like, can you just get this over with so these dudes don't even get confident? Like, please stop doing this kind of thing.
Raptors. He did one against the Raptors like that too. I remember when they had, I think it was that Bismack.
So, I think we just sufficiently covered these playoffs. I'm excited to have playoff basketball back with the wine and gold.
Very excited. Nervous. I always get very nervous.
Have you been at the Rock for like a playoff?
I have not
game?
Been at the Rock. My favorite was always the Let It Rock that they had with LeBron.
Lil Wayne and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, that was always my favorite.
My favorite was definitely that. I want to say, I don't know what it's called, but I always end up calling it like Nelly Furtado, but that's not the name of it. It's like you know what I'm talking about, that do, 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 clap, clap. Do,
I'm sure I do. I'm sure I do.
And then the scoreboard came down and the fire came out. And no matter where you were.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I know what you're talking about.
No matter where you were in the queue at the time.
Yes, I do know what you're talking about.
You felt your eyebrows burn off.
Rock will always stand out to me.
It was like, and they did it right before tip off. And then like, I think one year Ben Wallace got like lightheaded and stuff. And it was like, wait, we're actually hurting our own players. Like, we got to stop doing this.
Can't be doing that.
Now, that's gonna be exciting to see that. I feel like there's a part of me that's like, this is probably AC, Austin Carr's last hurrah?
Do we think so?
I don't know. It hasn't been announced, and I don't mean to project that, but it just feels like it. Like every time I see Doherty taking more of the reins and AC kind of winding down a little bit, I feel
like he really is.
They're just going to pop out and be like, all right, AC, he's just going to greet the guys at the stadium now kind of thing. So
he's going to be an usher.
Right.
He's going to be like the Charles Oakley role.
Did you see him at the game last night?
Who, Charles Oakley?
Oak was there wearing, he was in Drake's seats. And he had on the whole OVO sweater and all that kind of stuff.
No.
Oak still looks like he'll whoop some, like what we talked about last episode. You're like, Oak looks like.
The old man.
He was talking to people courtside, like Fred VanVleet.
Mess with him.
Whenever he talked to somebody, they stopped what they were doing and like, yes, sir. Like, I was like, man.
Absolutely.
Dude is a bully.
And you would forever. You would. If you met Charles Oakley, you would.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, from Cleveland. Yeah, I mean.
He is from Cleveland, isn't he?
You don't mess with nobody from Cleveland.
Is he from Cleveland Heights? He's got
to
be, right?
I have no idea. I know he went to, like, Virginia Union, but I'm not sure which neighborhood in Cleveland he's from.
Charles Oakley is. It just says Cleveland, Ohio.
Okay.
Go to, like, Heights High? John Hay. No, he went to John Hay.
He went to John Hay?
Yep.
I was about to say Gloomville or something like that. Like wherever city he's in, you feel like everybody knows to be like, yes, sir, Mr. Oakley. Like it's that's what it is.
My dad was from Cleveland Heights. I remember him talking about Charles Oakley. That's what I was thinking of.
Yeah, Oakley was no joke. So
no.
Yeah, that's playoff basketball's back. Rubber Rim Jobbers. Let's do this. Let's get this thing started here Saturday. We're gonna be good podcasters. We're gonna publish this here on Friday, so we got a whole day in advance.
Get it out in advance. Yep. And then, I don't think anybody's gonna argue with us about any of these takes. There's really no like super hot takes to have about this.
I think I call for some sweeps that, like you just said, people are gonna be like, no way in hell. I'm so sure that Phoenix and LAC is gonna be a sweep without Paul George. So I guess the one maybe that
we disagreed on was Hawks Celtics, but
okay, yeah, that's right.
Hawks Celtics. Yeah, but I mean, I'll put it to you this way: I'm not going to be wildly surprised if that one goes the other way.
Anticlimactic.
Yeah.
For all intents and purposes,
I don't like Trey. So
everybody, I don't like him either. I'm gonna just be honest with you.
Right.
Never have. As that game started, they had to cover on the actual broadcast that the Hawks front office had to go to him and say, we're not shopping you, even though you're probably hearing about it right now. So like they probably entertained the thought. Yeah. That'll be weird to see. Like if that comes, cause we just saw the death of the current Raptors. Like we know Nurse is not coming back. We know they're going to break that whole thing up and stuff. If they get swept by Boston, I think they'll explore it in Atlanta. So
Trey shot 33% from three this year. Not good at all, man.
It's the total antithesis of what Donovan and Darius did. Like they melded together pretty quickly and they really complement each other. It looks like for all intents and purposes, these DeJounte and Trey, they don't fit together super well. Like it's
I don't think it was ever realistic, but I remember there was talk of like whether Cavs were gonna get DeJounte.
I was a strong proponent of pulling that. I think, you know, like me, and I remember I was talking to Chris Rich about it because we were frustrated. You want to do a move like that because it's in front of you, and you're like, why are we passing on this if they're giving that guy away?
Right.
But once Donovan was like, once that actually got done, because it was like, we're not really in the running for that. Everybody knows he wants to be a Nick.
Oh, we were.
And he's going to be a Nick. There's no way we would even pony up for what they would want.
Right.
Once that happened, it was like, holy shit. Like, I'm so holy grateful shit. That did. Like, well, thank you so much.
He's been perfect. Yeah. He's been truly perfect.
So we'll see. I'm calling a sweep in the Boston-Atlanta series, but we'll see. We both have on our clairvoyant hats, and we'll see how this first round playoff kind of pulls
Any up. Other major playoff predictions here?
Or any other type of news? So I do believe Joel Embiid is going to be the MVP here. I do believe that Mike Brown is going to be the coach of the year.
Yeah,
rookie of the year, I'm a little more torn on, and I'm kind of like, I couldn't tell you who's going to be rookie of the year. Like, there's not a runaway this year where it's just like, yo, that dude really did his thing. I thought it was going to be Jaden Ivey, and then the Pistons entirely imploded. So,
right,
there's no way they can.
Probably Banchero.
There's no way they can reward him. I think so, Banchero, because as the season went on, they put the ball in his hands more, and they were surprisingly competitive. Like Orlando was. Orlando's going to be
Do you remember I told you at the beginning of the season, there was like, they were like 0-4. And I said, these guys are not like an 0-4 team. You go back.
I do remember you saying that.
Pull the tape. I said, these guys are going to end up being a much more competitive team than this.
As soon as the Cavs played them, I was like, oh shit. Like, they're long. They're tough.
They are.
Yeah.
They're going to be a playoff team next year.
I think so too. Good call. I agree.
I think they're going to be more like a play-in team than a playoff. I'm going to say, here's what I'm going to say. They're a play-in team next year.
Where they would be super dangerous is if they get that number two pick and get Scoot Henderson. Like, he would fit in perfectly with them. Right. He's a 6'2", 6'3" guard.
And that's probably what's going to happen. They're probably, what are they? Like, they're, what are they right now? Like, the fifth, seventh, fifth?
Yeah, range, if they got a little bit of luck and they were actually able to sneak up there.
So even if they don't and they just get, like, a good player, they're going to be dangerous. Develops. And they've got, I mean, they have other good players around them. Then I think they're going to be in that play-in range. And I think they're going to be something similar to like what the Raptors were this year.
They're so tough, man. They're so interchangeable with Wagner and Banchero and Bol Bol, like
positionless type stuff.
7'3" shooting guard. Like, it's some weird stuff happening down there. So,
yep. I think that's what you're looking at.
Yep. I don't know how we just closed this out with the Orlando Magic, but that's what happened just now.
That's what happened, man. We're here talking basketball. We're going to talk Cavs. Who's going to be the best player in the Cavs?
I'll tell you how we just did it. We were talking about end of the year awards. So I gave you my MVP. I gave you my coach of the year. I gave you, you gave me the rookie of the year. Thank you for that.
Mm-hmm. Defensive player of the year.
DPOY is, they're petitioning for it right now. Who do you got?
It's probably going to be Triple J, but I would love for it to be Mobley.
Yeah, he consistently throughout the year had like 4 and 5 blocks in most games. He made the All-Star game.
He averaged like over 3.
He made the All-Star game purely off of his defense. Like, it, the light finally switched on for him after 4 years of being one of the dumbest players in the league. He just was like, all right, I think I know how to do this now.
He can score, though.
Yeah, no, he can. He I think he's averaging like 1.7 or 1.8 threes. Like,
he always had that potential to be an all-around player. So he ended up doing 18. He does not rebound enough.
It's because he's on the perimeter so much. Like, he's doing like what Mobley does out there on the perimeter.
Yeah. And I guess that's true.
Aquaman. Who's out for the year.
Yeah, you're right. He scoops up. That's right. That's right.
So he eats up everything.
That's true.
So get this game started here Saturday, which will be tomorrow since we're publishing this on Friday. Playoff basketball's back. Jig is saying a 7-game knockout, drag-out series with the Cavs prevailing. Yes, sir. Rich is saying 6 games max. But we're ready for this thing. Let's get that. Let's get those, whatever the song is this year, and let's get those flames blowing there.
Let's get them going.
Yeah, let's rock this thing out.
Good, I'm ready.
Rubber rim job. Let's get these playoffs started.
Sign her up.
This is Joe Tate. Have a good night, everybody.